Ooh, I am getting feedback. Okay, hold on. Is that better? Oh, definitely picked up your burp.
Hello, and welcome to the podcast. My name is Patrick, and I'll be your chief flight attendant today. We'll begin the show in a few minutes, but first I'd like to acquaint you with some important safety information. Three sheets to the mouse may contain language and subject matters that aren't suitable for smaller aviators, so listener discretion is advised. When the intro music begins, please take a seat and partake of any carry-on items. This includes bottles, flasks, cans, fine cigars, and skin mags. Okay, let's review. That is, F-bombs, earmuffs, get drunk, smoke 'em if you got 'em, and send nudes. Anything else? Oh yeah, enjoy the show.
Sorted, but you'll be rewarded when at last I am given my dues. And in justice deliciously squared, be free, free.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode number 275 of Three Sheets to the Mouse. We're the podcast that likes to focus on the adult side of Disney, from parks to movies to dining. We'll cover everything Disney has to offer, including their drinks. You know this is going to be a quick episode because it's just myself, Mikey, and Maria this evening.
Hi.
Apparently, Jim Cantore called for a tornado to blow through Pennsylvania, and Tim and Adam are just now recovering from basically living like the wilderness people without any utilities or power.
They just got their power back today.
Yeah, I was watching Tim's TikTok. He was skinning a possum, and he had some type of, possum rigatoni he was going to put together for him. I mean, it has really been it's Lord of the Flies.
It's been
up
rough.
There.
It's been rough.
So thank goodness they finally got power restored.
Yeah.
So the tree varmints are safe once again.
Or maybe not. Maybe they like that possum rigatoni.
I mean, listen, it's a possum pasta.
It's an alliteration.
It really is. And that's the smartest thing Maria's going to say tonight.
No, that is not true. Now, come on.
it's not often you actually can use your degree and bring something to the show with it.
Okay, that is true. That is true.
For her next trick,
yes,
she'll use onomatopoeia.
Bang. That was it. That's an onomatopoeia.
And next week, she'll show you what third-person omniscient is.
That's when I always mess up this one and third person limited. Third person omniscient is when the narrator knows everything about each character.
Which the narrator kind of should, because it's their story.
Yes, but if it's third person limited, they only typically follow one character around. And they don't know what the other characters are doing when they're out of the scene.
Oh,
but third person omniscient is the narrator knows all about all characters. There you go.
So basically being a mom and a wife.
Correct. Welcome to my world.
That's why she's... And hey, if you want to sign up for her Grammarly course, please check her out.
I would probably not them paying me. I'd have to pay them.
Come on. Can they not sign up on your OnlyGrams?
My OnlyGrams? I should start.
No,
OnlyGrams.
That doesn't sound right. No, that would be for people who are into old ladies, I think.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, that's true.
But like not like dirty into old ladies, like, you know,
like,
they're baking
or
they're knitting.
Bake me a pie.
Yeah, exactly.
Crochet me a hat.
They'll
They'll walk you through how to sew a button back onto your shorts because your fat ass popped it.
Make me a washcloth.
At the pizza buffet. Or, and this is something you would probably make a lot of money, just a good breakfast gravy.
Oh, there you go.
That's what Granny does. Granny does gravy. Girl's right. Gone wild. Granny's gone gravy. Boy, that was about as off the rails as I think we could have gotten.
That's all right.
Right off the bat.
We got it out of the way to begin with.
Clearly, whoever's narrating this is third person limited.
Uh-huh.
Or they would have said, hey, get back on track. Maria, yeah. What are you drinking this evening? We had a late start, so hopefully you pregame.
I did, yeah. So I took Kellen out to dinner tonight, just Kellen and I. Had some mommy son time, and I had a passion fruit Mai Tai with dinner. So I came home really, really, really full because we ate a lot, and then Kellen wanted dessert, so we had dessert too. So I am just now drinking a non-alcoholic strawberry seltzer, like just a regular seltzer, because my stomach is so, so full. I can't put alcohol in this tum-tum right now. What about you? What are you drinking?
Well, I had kind of the opposite of your night.
Oh, no.
I had to chaperone 9 teenagers at a church pizza party thing, and a trip to the bounce house. But it's like a little bounce house. It's got like 60 trampolines and some dodgeball pit. So after that, we went out for a pizza buffet, and it wasn't like a regular pizza buffet. It's one of those where you go through the line one time, and they just keep walking around with full pizzas, serving them to you on your plate. So you don't have to get back up and go to the line.
Oh.
Yeah, it's a lazy man's buffet.
It's like Ohana dinner, but with pizza.
Yeah, and this place does like all the crazy weird kind of pizzas and shit like that. Like, you know, they got their baked potato pizza and this...
What?
Yeah. Oh yeah, it's a loaded baked potato on pizza crust. Sour cream, chives, cheese, diced up potato.
I don't know how to feel about that. I don't know how I would feel about that.
I mean, it feels great.
It was good? You liked it?
It's fantastic. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Huh. I always like that. It's great.
Huh.
You got to come to the South and live a little.
Apparently.
So, anyway, to answer your question from 5 minutes ago... while your evening you had a drink and it sounds like it was pretty chill and relaxed. Mine, however, was not.
Uh-oh.
Specifically, I had to drive the bus, so there was no drinking involved. Mm-hmm. So I'm bottling down my Jim Beam that I've been nursing on for a little while tonight.
Nice.
So I've earned it after some of these kids did not receive their medication before they left the house.
Oh no! Or do you have it straight or is it on the rocks?
It's on a big damn rock.
Good for you.
Just a big ice ball.
Yeah.
It looks like the Death Star.
They're the best. Oh, yeah. Todd has one of those, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm on Target.
Yeah. Nice.
But that's what we're drinking. Nothing for her. Something for me. What are you drinking? Let us know on Facebook. Facebook.com/group/3sheets. Join us if you haven't yet. Give us a toast. We'd love to hear from you. Man, that is quickie because I'm moving right along. Okay. Let's jump into this episode. This is... minimal prep, which, I mean, that's all of our episodes.
That's how we typically do it.
And I mean, I've been wanting to do something akin to this for a little while because, oh, man, way, way back, like, all of the hosts back, original lineup back, we had an episode where we just kind of briefly touched on the... barely announced concept of Disney Plus. Not even the Disney Plus concept. Just that Disney had purchased Hulu and hired a guy who was in charge of Amazon streaming services. And I remember saying this, all this points to Disney having a streaming service. And, you know, we talked about it then. And then when Disney Plus came out, we let it sit for a couple months and we visited on it a little bit, you know, what we think about what's there. But I've always wanted to kind of go back and look at it again, because I will say this quite interestingly, Disney has been really quietly removing content.
Yeah.
After they threw a ton of it out there, they've I don't want to say scaled back, but they straight up removed an entire movie that they made just for Disney Plus that literally came out 2 months ago. They've already pulled it because it did not do well. And I don't know, like, I don't understand the metrics on streaming as far as how something does, because unless you're putting something out there that's going to generate new subscribers, you're not really getting a return on investment for the content, you know?
Right.
So it's hard to say, well, this just didn't perform very well. I mean, but it wasn't, it was aimed at children, and children don't pay bills and sign up for streaming plans. So
right.
They have to know going into this that there's going to be some things they put out that won't be a hit with the bill-paying audience. And we watched it here. I mean, it was fine. I mean, I've seen worse.
What was the movie that came out that they just
Crater?
Pulled? I didn't even hear of it.
Or Crater. I say they just pulled it. This is a couple news articles I read. I haven't gone back and looked for it, so I can't say for sure.
Oh, okay. All right.
But, I mean, an adventure, you know, movie about kids that live on the moon. And then they sneak off and go explore a crater, and some, you know, hijinks happen. And
okay.
Not good. I mean, you know, perilous hijinks.
Right, yeah.
You know, I mean, it's basically Stand By Me, but on a moon with no dead body.
Huh.
Or any other group of kids trying to beat them up to get to... So really, it's nothing like Stand By Me. But the main character in Stand By Me was in Star Trek, so they are really close. They are
there
a lot
you go.
Alike.
You there
know.
You go, buddy.
Will Wheaton. But yeah, so there's been a lot of shuffling on content there, especially with the addition of a lot of the Fox shit that's popping up down there. So
yeah, there's a
Maria
lot
and I
of
are,
stuff
are,
from Fox that they don't have. A
yeah,
lot.
Well, and I mean, they don't need it all.
No.
That's the downside of this is they don't need it all. Someone's
right.
going to get mad because they don't have the one obscure movie or ABC sitcom that you watched when you were a kid, but it's like they don't need it all. I mean, they just don't. And they don't need all of the Fox stuff because it's a lot of stuff. They need the high points, the heavy hitters like your Simpsons and your Family Guy and I guess the Orville. Which I tried watching it. I haven't watched it. It wasn't bad. It was funny enough.
No.
But I digress. We're not talking about what's on Disney Plus. We're talking about what's not on Disney Plus and not necessarily anywhere else, you know?
Right.
Disney, if they're looking to outsource ideas for content, we got you, okay? This is where you need to sit right here, streaming executives, because we're about to make your fourth quarter.
Hopefully. Maybe we'll see some changes.
Or at least a touchdown. Or I don't know. Is that football analogy? Fourth quarter?
Yes.
Okay, we're about to make your 2-minute warning.
There you go.
We're red zone defense, baby. This is a nickel package.
That's you're done. You're good.
This is we're on a dime bag.
Nope.
Okay.
Nope. Dime bag is not. Nope. That's something else.
It's Daryl.
Well, and the thing that I
have, we should have done this live.
I know, right? The thing that I have noticed about my list especially is that, I mean, we know that, like, the 90s specifically is, like, big right now. Like, you know, 90s fashion, 90s hairstyles, like, all of that is kind of coming back.
Is it, though?
It is.
I mean, but is it, though?
It is.
Like, I see some of the stuff from, like, when I was living in the 90s, and I'm like, that has no business ever coming back.
Oh, I 100% agree with you. However,
the thing is, though,
it may,
yeah, it's good.
It's
coming
back.
And when we got it fucking at Walmart for, I mean, the whole pants and shirt set was like $18 maybe.
Yeah.
But now it's coming back and it's fucking high-end stuff that you can only get mail order, and it's like $80
right.
for just a windbreaker, and you're like,
well,
no.
That's true. So because the 90s are becoming popular all over again,
They've always been popular for those that live.
Well, for some of us, yes, that's true. But I'm surprised that I'm surprised that Disney hasn't looked back at some of their most popular things from the 90s and put them, like, there's seriously some stuff missing here. So as I'm looking over my list, I'm like, oh, that was from the 90s, and that's from the 90s, oh, and that's from the 90s.
Yeah,
so my list is just definitely like an older, like, stuff that I grew up with that I want my kids to see, because that's how I grew up. I watched things that my parents used to watch when they were little, and I kind of want that same nostalgic, like, stuff to infiltrate into my kids' lives. So my first thing on my list is the new Mickey Mouse Club from 1989 to 1994. And this is the one that had Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera and Justin Timberlake, JC Chazet, Ryan Gosling, like, all of the Carrie Russell. Like, I distinctly remember watching this on a daily basis when I got home from school, when we finally were able to purchase the Disney Channel, because it wasn't standard with the cable package then.
I was going to say, I've never seen this, but then you mentioned purchase the Disney Channel, and that, yeah, reminds me. Yeah, no.
Oh.
We didn't buy the Disney Channel, like, so there's no way that I would have seen this.
It was like basically a kid's version of SNL.
I mean, I'm familiar with kids sketch comedy stuff.
Yeah.
Because Nickelodeon was free, and we watched a lot of that.
Yes.
I mean, I'd like to introduce you to some guys called You Can't Do That on Television.
I remember that. And was it All That?
Okay, that was way after You Can't Do That on Television. But yes, all That was with Amanda Bynes before she went psycho.
Really? No, wait. Yeah. What was what You Can't Do That on Television? Was that the sketch comedy on the kids' sketch comedy on Nickelodeon?
I mean, it was still sketch comedy, but this was okay. Like mid to late 80s.
Okay, that was probably before I started watching stuff on.
So it was Canadian, and then Nickelodeon optioned it for the States.
Whatever Kenan and Kel were on Nickelodion, that's what I remember.
I think
watching.
That was All That.
Was it? I think. Okay,
yeah, that is definitely not. Yeah, that is but far removed from You Can't Do That on Television as anything, because I'm not going to get into it. I mean, I can. I keep going on, but no.
No, focus, Mikey. But I would love to see that the new Mickey Mouse Club on just... It was so good. Like, I...
Like, brought back the original episodes, or, like, redone with...
Well,
With a new cast.
Well, actually, I'm really surprised that they haven't done another Mickey Mouse Club for, like, this generation. Because usually every, like, 20 years or so, 20, 30 years or so, they do that. And it's about time. Like, the original Mickey Mouse Club was in the 50s. And then the new one was the late 80s. So it's time for a new Mickey Mouse Club.
I think maybe the reason that they haven't, or why that's a little difficult or something, is the sheer quantity of movies right now starring kids that age that are even coming to Disney Plus,
yeah,
and other Disney Plus television series that, again, have kids that age that would be featured on the Mouse Club. They're busy working somewhere else. I mean, back in the 90s, when you had your Britney and your Justin and your JC and your Ryan and your Christina Habanero, there was there was nothing else for them to do, you know?
Yeah.
So now it's no longer a jumping point, because and with your tube talk, those funny kids are doing it on their own without having to deal with executives and managers and stuff, because they're making their own content for YouTube, TikTok, and stuff like that.
That's true.
So
yeah.
I kind of sounded pretty good as I thought through that on the fly.
Yeah, you did. Look at you. But yeah, I'd love to see something that was, that my kids could watch, that was a sketch comedy, because I loved watching that stuff. And that kind of catapulted me as I got older into SNL, because once I kind of phased out of the kid stuff, as I got into high school, or, you know, like as I got into the end of middle school into high school, that was a perfect time for me to kind of like transition into SNL stuff. So I thought it was a good jumping off point to get kids interested in comedy bits. Because otherwise you kind of fall into it, you know, if your parents are into it or if you just happen to stumble upon it one day. But this was like a really good way to introduce like some improv, some comedy sketches, some lines, some, you know, really great songs and dancing. Mm-hmm. And like, it was just so good. And I remember loving it so much. And I may or may not have all of them on tape somewhere.
My intro to comedy was getting up early one Saturday morning, sneaking down to the living room, and trying to catch Babar and Friends on HBO.
Oh, I fucking loved Babar. Wait, that's probably not the same Babar that I'm thinking of.
The cartoon elephant?
Oh, yeah, Babar. Yeah. Okay.
And because, you know, we had a de-scrambler, because, again, we didn't pay for shit. And I got the time wrong. It was not 6:30. It was 5:30 in the morning, apparently, where I live. And instead of Babar, I got to watch an early stand-up of Howie Mandel. And I remember thinking, I should not be hearing these words, but they're funny. What's he going to do with that glove? Oh, my God.
That's hysterical.
And it was downhill from there for me, I guess. I don't know.
All right, what's something on your list?
Okay, well, you know, it's a little bit ironic, don't you think? Alanis Morissette sung that song.
I was gonna say she's on your list.
No, but she was one of the child actors in "You Can't Do That on Television." So I'm just kind of bringing it back around. Nice. That was where she got her start.
I didn't know that. That's what I didn't realize. That.
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
So anyway, No, it is. It's not ironic. It's just a coincidence that pretty much all of mine also are 90s nostalgia from when I was a kid.
I know.
Just like yours.
It
just
was
like
hard. Yours. I have one thing that's not. Well, maybe I do as well. Technically two. Two things that aren't. But yeah, most of mine are.
So my first three, I mean, but we'll go one at a time. They're gimmies, and everybody that has known me on this podcast for any length of time knows kind of where I'm going. And Maria, did you have a chance to catch the Chip and Dale, the Rescue Rangers movie that came out last year?
No, I didn't. Oh. I heard it was good, though.
It really, 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 really is. Like, it was way better than I was expecting it to be, and I'm very critical on a lot of film.
Is that still on, or did they pull that one, too?
Hopefully it's still there, because it was really good.
Okay, I'll have to look
it up. And I liked that. So I would actually like to see that continue in, like, an episodic format, you know? Even if it's just, like, one season, or, like, a one series spinoff, like the Muppets Mayhem series, you know, which is also really good. And I think it would be hilarious if it was along those same lines, because this sees them living in the real world as cartoons, which actually reminds me so much of Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which did not make my list because it's pure perfection. Don't fuck with it.
Well, and that's on Disney Plus, is it not?
I believe it is, yes.
Okay, I was going to say. Yes. I can't imagine it wouldn't be.
But I would like to see, you know, more of Chip and Dale as the Rescue Rangers interacting with other actors and celebrities and stuff. Like I said, kind of like what you had with the Muppets.
Yeah.
I would love for them to encounter all these actors and stuff that have been in other spy or espionage type movies and stuff like that, as cameos for them to run along with and just solve some silly, you know, and it could even be one long storyline.
Yeah.
Or whatever. But I mean, could you imagine they
like a minisode kind of thing? Like a
like
a miniseries?
Yeah, like Secret Invasion or whatever, eight episodes long, you know. But they, you know, they run into fucking Daniel Craig.
Oh my god.
Who's walking around with his southern accent. Like from Glass Onion or from Knives Out. You know, and if you haven't seen that, it's great when you need to check those out. But his character, then they can run into him again later dressed up like James Bond. Because both of them are kind of detective, you know, spy kind of roles for the same character. I don't know.
Awesome.
I think it'd be a lot of fun to revisit that. And like I said, I do miss the Rescue Rangers. I miss like all of that after school Disney Power.
Yeah, they were awesome.
4 hour or 2 hour block on ABC or whatever it was. Yeah, it was all.
The first
ABC.
One was what? Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers, and then Tailspin.
I think you had DuckTales.
DuckTales
was like I think the first one. I don't know. It probably aired in a different order.
And Darkwing Duck
based on
was part
syndication,
of it. And, oh,
depending
God,
on where you were. So
it was so good.
Yeah, but I would get a kick out of having Chip and Dale come back, and I would even be fine with them being voiced by Andy Samberg and John Mulaney again, like they were in the movie, because they were great. Their timing off of each other was just spot on. So, and also Maria, check that out. Check that movie out if it's still up there, because the kids will like it.
Yeah,
and it's also just chock full of cameos.
Kellen is, and it pains me because I fucking hate this movie. Kellen is so into Alice in Wonderland right now. I hate it so much. It is on.
I hate that for you.
Every single day, multiple times a day. He literally, it ends, he starts it over. What the hell? The weirdest fucking movie. I can't stand it. It's so bad.
It's moments like that I miss having VHS as the only form of media, because eventually that fucking tape wears out.
Yep.
Sorry, bud, it's wore out. I can't fix that. Yeah, I'm sorry.
You
looks
watched
like
it
you gotta
so much.
Watch the sequel.
Oh, great. Thank God there isn't one.
Yes, there is.
Oh, no.
Yes, there is.
Oh no. I'm gonna can I delete something from his account? Can I block something from his account? Is that
I think
I able
you can.
To do that?
I think you can,
right.
Yeah.
I'm fucking blocking that shit right there. Alright, so this one is one of the only ones. This next one is one of the only ones that I grew up watching it because my parents grew up watching it. And I am surprised that like some of the older stuff that I was looking over, like a list of like 700 things that are not on Disney Plus. And as I was looking at some of the older TV shows, I was like, oh yeah, why don't they have that on Disney Plus? Zorro, the original TV series of Zorro was so fucking good. And it was in black and white.
Yep.
And we watched it all the time because it's something that my parents grew up watching. And it was just so good. And I'm sure, like, I'm remembering it through rose-colored glasses, through my kid goggles. Like, as a child, I remember watching this and just being completely enamored with, like, the stunts that they did and the love story and, the like, all of that stuff. And I'm sure if I watched it again, I'd be like, that's fucking stupid. But I prefer to lead with my rose-colored rendition of what was happening. And I fucking loved Zorro. It was so good. I would love to see some of the older stuff, some of the older TV shows back on.
I think Disney. It's just really, really difficult to put out black and white stuff now and expect the masses to still consume it.
But even if it was just like, here's what they need to start doing. They need to start doing like limited releases, like for a limited time. Here's your mm-hmm. vault from the 50s. Here's your vault from the 60s.
Yeah, I agree with that.
And I think that would drum up some stuff. And then you put it on for a little bit and then you take it off. And if you did that, I think it would probably... people would know that there's only a finite amount of time that I can watch this. Let me go watch it now before it's... I think they need to bring back that idea of the Disney vault.
Yeah.
And start doing some stuff like that. So. But yeah, Zorro. It's good shit.
I think I saw the Antonio Banderas.
Oh, the movie is really good. So good.
Because it had that Catherine Zeta-Douglas.
Yeah.
Catherine Zeta-Pym.
I want to say that that was her first movie. Or one of her. I mean, I know it was one of her first movies, but I'm pretty sure that was the first movie I saw her in. I ever saw her in. Been. And it was so good. It was great. But I don't think that Disney... I mean...
I don't think they did that one.
I don't think they did that one, but they should have. Like, that should have been a Disney live action. Why wasn't it? I don't know.
Well, they were a different company when it came to film then.
True.
The closest you're going to get to that would have been Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, true. Well,
that had all your swashbuckling. And
yeah, but Zorro, the TV series, was on the Disney Channel. I remember because that's where we watched it. Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming that Disney owns the rights of Zorro.
Maybe the distribution of it?
Maybe. That's true.
Maybe just the rights to...
to distribute.
Syndicate it.
Yeah. That's true.
During their Boomer Power Hour.
Yeah. Yeah, The Mask of Zorro was so good. Disney, we know you listen. Here's what we want. We want a vault for some of the old TV shows and some of the older, like, movie stuff that's not on. Like, The Gnomemobile, that's not on there either. And I like that movie. What's the next thing on your list?
Well, you've already covered it.
Oh, no. What did I do?
It's Tailspin.
Oh.
But I want it redone. Like, I don't want necessarily the originals. I want new content like we've got, like they did with DuckTales, you know?
Yeah, that would be good.
I want new content, mostly because I would like to see a bit more fresh approach to it, because that Disney would be able to take different angles with some of the characters. Yeah. Specifically, I would love more backstory between Kit and Rebecca.
Oh.
Because I don't know... And maybe in the early episodes they brief it, but it's like, okay, he was your orphan, I assume, orphan, that ends up with this ragtag group of do-gooders.
Right.
But how is, you know, someone's going to probably jump on there and say, well, here's why. here's a Tailspin fandom. But I really feel like right now there's a good market for something like this, for a re-release, but also it's got a lot of fun potential with action and stuff like that, especially with that old goofy wildcat.
Yeah.
You know, I would like to... I would just love to see that one come back and just explore more than what we got. More backstory, because I don't know, but Baloo's Baloo, but I'm more focused on the weird familial dynamic they've got going on there, which could allow Disney to touch on a lot more difficult topics like they really enjoy doing in their movies and TV shows. About not having your birth family and adoption or fostering and, you know, stuff like that. Yeah. I mean, did you... There's a whole world they could go through with this, and you'd be able to have parents watching it with kids at the same time, because the writing would work well for both, and I just whatever it takes to get me some Don Carnage.
Oh. And such a great character.
I love all the fact that they fly all those vintage style planes. It never actually says what era it takes place in. It's everything's got like an Art Deco vibe. But I
always think of that as like the same time as the Rocketeer.
I mean, I could see that, but that's not how Rebecca's dressing.
Oh, that's
true.
If
you go back and look at her outfits, it's more like 1990s women's business with her pleated pants and her her blouses and stuff like that. Like, yeah. It doesn't really...
Well, but her hairstyle is
her
very...
Her hairstyle is kind of up, yeah.
50s, yeah, 60s. So,
I don't know. I think... But they're also stuck on an island. Maybe time moves a little differently there.
That's true.
Maybe they're just,
well,
you know...
Well, and that's kind of when the 50s into the 60s is kind of when women started wearing pants. Pleated pants like that, too.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I think I'm sticking with, like, the time of, like, the Rocketeer, like, the 50s or 60s. Right?
I'm thinking...
Or was the Rocketeer earlier than that?
No, it was 40s.
Was it? Okay.
Yeah, it was during the World War II because the Nazis were there.
Oh, right. You're right. You're right.
Well,
all right. Well, maybe it's...
In my brain, it's present day. They've just got old planes because it's all they can afford down there. Like those areas in Alaska where they keep flying those old-ass planes with the big radial engines because...
True.
Cost a fortune to keep them running, but they were cheap to come by. So, yeah, I'm just... It sounds like I'm phoning it in, but I actually did put quite a bit of thought into where I'm going with all this.
No, I think that's good.
So Chippendale and Tailspin, but not just the same old stuff. I want, you know, I want to see it brought back.
Well, and you could still have Jim Cummings do the voice.
Well, sure,
of
yeah.
Of Don Carnage.
And probably several others.
That's true.
I mean, I don't have it pulled up, but I got a feeling like he's half the cast.
Nope. That is the only one he did.
Really?
Oddly enough, because typically when he does a voice, he does... he doesn't just do a voice, he does voices.
Right. Yeah, he talks to himself.
Yeah. Which is an amazing talent. The way that he does it. All right, so my next one is a flashback to the 90s just because I still watched it in the 90s, even though they were made earlier than the 90s. And that's Schoolhouse Rocks because they made them up until, I think, like 96 or 97, the newer ones.
Yeah, but who has their fingers on that?
Disney owns them.
Really?
Yes, they do. Yep.
Well, I'll be the first one to tell you that, yes, bring that back.
I know.
Because I'm not saying that teachers aren't doing a good job. Kids aren't learning the same way.
Right. And that's I feel like that especially is an integral. Holy shit. That was a huge part of.
I knew you shot your wad early. With alliteration.
Mikey, cut this. 40 minutes and 24 seconds. Okay, make sure you cut that.
Sure.
It was, I just remember that being such a huge part of my elementary career. And it is much easier to learn things when they are put to rhyme and song. And that's just... that there have been so many studies on that. It is so much easier for a child to remember something. That's why we sing our ABCs. That's why we sing nursery rhymes. Like, it's because it's easier to remember. So something like Schoolhouse Rock, if we can't use it, like it would be, what teacher doesn't have a Disney Plus subscription? Most of them do.
Right.
So, I mean, especially an elementary teacher, just make our lives easier, Disney. Put it on there. Thank you. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
I agree. I agree with that. That's a great idea. I did not know that Disney had the rights to Schoolhouse Rock.
I didn't either until I started looking at
I keep wanting to say School of Rock.
But no.
Yes, Schoolhouse Rock. And you know what? Speaking of School of Rock, fuck it. Just let Jack Black recover all the songs.
Yeah. Holy shit. Jack Black doing Schoolhouse Rocks? Oh,
right?
My God.
Right? Can you not already hear him singing I'm Just a Bill right now?
Oh, that would be amazing. Holy shit, yes.
Yeah. Oh, Disney, this is a I don't want to say a no-hitter. This is a no-brainer, a heavy home run. God, I am sports balling it poorly tonight.
That's okay. We both are.
Okay, so my next one here, just keeping with the theme, I'm sure everybody listening is like, I know what you're going to say next. I know what you're going to say next.
If you don't, I'm coming down there and I'm strangling you, because it better fucking be on your list.
But now go with me on this. So I've discussed Chippendale.
Yes.
I've discussed Tailspin.
Yes.
And I want series of both of these. Okay. And I want them to culminate in the crossover event of the decade, where Chippendale come together with Tailspin, because you got Chippendale working a case of a kidnapped kid.
Okay.
And the whole while they're trying to work on this, they keep getting impeded by some kind of dark cloaked vigilante that's also working on crimes in the town as well, albeit with a bit more of a violent tendency. So yeah,
not where I thought you were going.
Vigilante is Darkwing Duck.
I thought you were going for Ernest Saves Christmas.
No. Sorry. Didn't mean to let you down.
Man.
I was staying true to my
You think you know a guy.
Hello, dear listeners. This is Mikey jumping in real quick here. As I'm editing this episode, and I needed to, you know, do a quick disclaimer before anyone grabs pitchforks and lights their torches and takes to the Facebook group to let me know how much of an idiot I am, that I know I'm an idiot. And if you've been paying attention to this podcast at all over the last 4 years, you too should know that I'm an idiot. So just please understand that I'm about to get into an argument with Maria over a topic that is near and dear to my heart, that apparently I know jack shit about. So please just bear with me and understand that whatever I say between now and the next 15 seconds, I don't know what I'm talking about. So that starts in 3, 2, 1, now.
Also, they don't own it. They
yes,
don't have the
they
rights.
They do.
I don't know that, no, ma'am.
It was filmed there. What are you talking about?
That was just the studio lot. They don't have it. Trust
what?
Me.
Oh man.
So, you've got Chippendale working on this kidnapped thing. That the kid that's kidnapped is Kit Cloud Kicker. So it's this crossover between Chippendale and Tailspin. And they end up solving the case and getting him rescued. And as a reward, they get to go on vacation at Cape Suzette, you know, courtesy of Baloo and Rebecca. And they're out there just having a great time and stuff like that. But, you know, while they're palling around and schmoozing with the uppity-ups down there, they meet this wealthy philanthropist named Drake Mallard, who happens to also be there as well, keeping tabs on them, because that's Darkwing Duck's Bruce Wayne.
That's what he does.
Drake Mallard. So this would be the launching off point to bring back just the best Caped Crusader ever, which would be Darkwing Duck. Just bring it back, but I would not want it as campy.
You'd want it to be like a little bit more.
I don't want it to be serious, but. Yeah, I would want it to be a little. I don't want to say dark, but I would go with the same tone that the Batman the Animated Series had.
Okay, so more teen instead of kid.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, and I think that would be fun. Now, interestingly, when this happens, Chip has to. Chip and Dale, they both end up going back to their two-dimensional selves.
Oh.
For you'd have to watch the movie to understand what I mean by that. But there's I'm sure the writers could come up with a garbage bullshit reason why that happens that I can ultimately pick apart because that's what I do. But as long as we get to that point, because this wouldn't have to be done like in the real world or anything like that. So yeah, I'd need two towels to clean up with after watching an episode like that. So basically what this is doing is it's like the Flash and the Arrow on the CW, and then it turns into, there's a new episode coming, a new series. So, yeah.
You know, I've heard such good things about each of those, and I never got to watch them.
It's like me trying to watch the Star Wars animated things. You'd be so far behind.
Yeah.
I think there's 7-8 seasons of Flash. And,
oh,
like,
really?
6 seasons of Arrow, I think. No, maybe 8 seasons of Arrow, because it was already established before The Flash. Yeah, and it ends up being just a whole lot to keep up with as it goes on with all the lands. But Flash really is good. That one is really, 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 really good. It'll make you hate everything that Warner Brothers has put out with The Flash in it. Ezra guy as The Flash, because the only true Flash is Grant Gustin.
Got it. He
plays it in... Anyway, moving forward, give me some Mo.
I want the original Muppet Babies from 84 to 91. I liked the reboot, but nothing is better than the original. I'm sorry.
Nope, I agree.
It was my favorite TV show growing up. My sister and I used to fight over that or Fraggle Rock. Because I guess they were both on at the same time. I don't know how or why that was a thing, but...
Fraggle Rock would have been on HBO at the time.
Really?
Yeah, it was always only on HBO.
Oh, okay, so then I guess that's why that was like that. Because... Oh, I guess that's before Disney owned the Muppets.
Disney doesn't own all of... the Muppet. Disney owns the Muppets, but not everything Jim Henson put out, and the Fraggles were part of that. This is just Jim Henson.
Okay.
Like, there's a lot of other Muppets.
Right.
Which the Muppets are just the puppet characters that he created.
Like, they don't own Sesame Street.
Correct.
But that's Jim Henson. Mm-hmm. So they don't own Fraggle Rock?
Disney does not, no. That's why the reboot of Fraggle Rock was, again, only on HBO Plus.
Got it. Okay. That makes sense.
Or then. HBO Now or HBO Mega, I don't know, all these fucking services. It's Plus and it's Max and whatever.
Yeah. Okay, that makes sense then. But yeah, I want the original Muppet Babies. It was so good.
I can hear the theme song.
Oh, so can I. Muppet Babies.
Make our dreams come true.
Muppet Babies.
Do the same for you.
Do you have any more on your list? I've just got one more.
I do. And okay. this one, so this doesn't go back to the 90s. And it's a big ask, so just kind of follow me on this. But sometime back before Disney Plus was a real thing, or maybe when it was just in its conceptual talking head stages, or they were just getting ready to roll it out, Disney was needing content, like original content, not just their vault.
Right.
Okay. And their catalog and stuff like that. So Disney actually approached Kevin Smith, stoner extraordinaire, director, you know, movie maker, a guy who's made his entire living making bad movies.
I mean, you're not totally wrong.
I'm not totally wrong.
No, you're not.
But they approached him about doing a show based off the Kingdom Keepers novel series.
I would not be upset about that.
And I've never read the Kingdom Keepers. I've heard of it. My absolute briefest research on it says that the plot follows the adventures of five teens who by day are holographic hosts in the Disney theme parks, but by night they battle Disney villains to keep them from taking control of the parks, the Disney Entertainment Empire, and the world. From Wikipedia.
Yeah.
Now, regardless of your opinion on Kevin Smith and his typical movies and stuff like that, you cannot deny the man knows a fandom and how to provide content and cater to that fandom. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they tapped him, and he was reading all the books. He was reading the books, and he was writing scripts and putting together screenplays and going full in on this. Like, he was employed. He was being paid to do all this work by Disney, and he's developing this, and Disney's trying to get, at the same time, the right leadership in line for their streaming service. And, you know, Kevin Smith, he gets to see the tech that Disney is working on, so he gets to go and look at the volume before it was ever used for filming The Mandalorian, with all those, that whole LCD wall, and basically now it's used in virtually everything that goes to Disney Plus.
Right.
If they need, you know, we don't really need to go on location anymore. We can just do it in here. And sidebar, I think content is suffering because of that, but I digress.
Yeah. There's no
looking at you, Pinocchio. I'm looking at you, Pinocchio. I'm looking at you, Pinocchio.
Yeah. Oh, that was fucking horrible. So, but I feel like something is lost when it's not, when you're not there, you're not on location as much as you can be. It's a cop out. I think. It's
I agree. Yeah. And it saves money in the long run. I get that. That's how they're able to put out a ton of those shows and series and stuff like that, but I do feel like quite a bit is lost in that.
Yep.
So anyway, Smith, he's writing these scripts, and the scripts get passed around, and the executives are excited with what he's doing, the whole ideas and stuff, and then they make their way back up to the new guy Disney just hired to basically be in charge of all of the streaming service, Mr. Plus.
Mm-hmm.
In the Disney Plus, and he looked at it and he was like, "Yeah, no, let's just make Marvel and Star Wars stuff."
I feel like that would have been so good.
Well, here's where, according to Kevin Smith's podcast, he was going back and going through this, and he's not upset about it or anything. He's like, you know, word got back to him, and it came down to this: this executive was looking at it, and he says, there's too many IPs in this script. Like, it's every fucking Disney character alive ever is in this show.
Well, yeah.
And that's too much. That's too much. That's too many IPs. So, it's just too much stuff. So that's why it got canceled. His ambition was his own downfall. That was a shame, but that did birth what we got with the first season of The Mandalorian, basically took its place,
right.
Kind of. So, you know, it's not really a thing to be mad about.
No, of course not.
But at the same time, this would have been
so good.
I think it would have too. Now, I don't know if it was going to be a live action or if it was going to be an animated, because that would be pretty tough to do live action, I think, just because so many of your villains are literally larger than life.
Yeah.
You know, like, your evil queen.
Yeah.
I mean, some Disney characters only work when you meet them in a park as head characters.
Yes.
I
would agree with
that.
Evil
Queen, Jafar, not Evil Queen, the Queen of Hearts. But, like, Jafar works pretty well as a head character.
Yeah.
You have come across. So, I don't know. Also, I would be leery of this because me and the kid are going through, and he's been watching all of Once Upon a Time, which is a lot.
It is. That's a long series. It's good though.
It is not.
I liked
it. It is not good at all.
I liked it.
I can find no redeeming quality.
Really? Oh, that's
the Evil Queen's cleavage. That's about all I got.
Oh, I see. I really liked it.
I really don't. And as it keeps going, it gets worse. And that's, I would be afraid that as something like this got going, it would and the amount of IPs getting put in there kept climbing.
Yeah,
it would start degrading just because of. It's so much. Like every time they bring a new character into Once Upon a Time, it's not great.
That is I'll give you that. When Anna and Elsa showed up, that was that was pretty ridiculous. So.
Anna was spot on. I have honest to goodness never come across an Elsa that worked for me. I have
I wonder why that is.
I can't get into that? Australian Belle at all.
No, I don't.
At all.
No, I don't blame you.
There's just a lot of questionable decisions that were made in that.
Yeah.
I do love, I can't remember his name, but the guy who plays Rumpelstiltskin /
Mr. Gold.
It's his show and they're all just acting. Well, it's him and old Regina.
Yeah.
The evil queen. It's their show. Everybody else is just super tertiary characters.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's everything that I got that I want back.
All right.
So far.
The last thing that I want, again, growing up in the 90s, this was like, oh God, it was one of our favorite movies. I love this movie so much. I want Father of the Bride on. The one with
Steve Martin
and Diane Keaton and Martin Short. I want it. That's the one I want.
And that one 90s girl who was in a lot of those
movies. She
got
married to...
maybe just specifically those movies.
She got married to Brad Paisley. That's Brad Paisley's wife.
I forget.
Yeah. Kimberly Williams is the girl that is in Father of the Bride. That's who married Brad Paisley. But yeah, I want Father of the Bride, and I want Father of the Bride 2.
And those aren't on Disney Plus.
They are not.
And Disney owns them.
They do.
That's weird.
Mm-hmm. They were so good. So good. Like, talk about a family movie, like a family, whole family, sit down, watch it, laugh out loud movie.
That's what Steve Martin brings.
I know. Now I
mean, I guess
to...
you could always go to Hulu and you could watch Only Murders in the Building.
I know. Which I haven't gotten into yet. So I know it is half the cast. I haven't gotten into that yet, but I've heard it's really good and I want to start watching it.
And
that
the Selena Gomez, who's also Disney, so.
Right. Come on, Disney. Get your shit together.
I mean, they did. They put it on Hulu.
That's true. All right, touche. Touche on
so
that.
So maybe they do a spoof of it that takes place in the world of the Lion King, and they call it Father of the Pride.
There you go.
I think they could do that. And then
they were just so good. Know. Those movies were just so freaking good. And the fact that my dad went around for years quoting the Father of the Bride.
I've never done that.
Oh my God, he quotes.
I think I've only seen each of them like once or twice, like not enough to. I know they were witty in that, and I laughed, but like that's not my kind of comedy.
Oh yeah,
it's not my level of funny.
My dad quotes it consistently, still to this day, like 30 years later, still quotes the movie.
Do you have any honorable mentions of shit that should not be or things Disney should just leave well enough alone?
I don't. I think I really like this idea of limited time showings. Do you know, like having something, you know, whether it's a year, like 1955, and they bring back the most popular TV shows from 1955 that Disney owns, or like, I don't know, I'm not quite sure what that would look like, or maybe they do a decade or something like that, or like an action adventure, you know, because like Daniel Boone's not on it. I don't know that they have Davy Crockett on right now.
They do.
He was King of the Wild Frontier.
I know. They definitely don't have Daniel Boone on it. That was from 64 to 70. Good old Fess. They have
right in the neck.
There's right in the fucking neck. He got stabbed. I feel like there's so much brotherly love. Oh my God, do you remember that TV show with the brothers, the three of them? Fuck, what are their names?
Nick Lawrence. Jonas.
The Lawrence brothers. Joey Lawrence, Matthew Lawrence, and then I forget what the youngest ones.
I just want to go on record saying I was pretty fucking close with the Jonas brothers. You want to be honest.
Yeah, no, you definitely were. Yeah, there's so many things.
No, I'm afraid I didn't ever see the Brotherly Love.
That was a good one. I think that was part of TGIF for a little bit, too.
Oh, yeah?
If I remember.
See, I would love getting some TGIF back. I would love to get the original Full House, Family Matters.
Yep.
You know, Step by Step. Okay, give me Suzanne step, Summers.
Day by day.
And Patrick Duffy.
Yeah. Oh, God.
And the first guy I ever saw named Sasha.
Yeah, right?
Right. And then the only other guy I've ever seen named Sasha is Borat. So I guess it's F2. I'm at two.
There you go. Yeah, there's a bunch of things that they own that aren't.
But you know what's funny is we've still got Meet the Deedles.
On Disney Plus.
On Disney Plus.
Who's watching that one?
Not like, me.
No, honestly, who is watching that one? Because that one is so bad.
Now, before you say something you're going to regret.
It's Mikey.
Before you say something you're going to regret, we're going to leave the Country Bears out of this. This is not their fight. Okay. I think actually that one did get pulled off.
I was going to say that can't be on there still. I don't.
If it is, I'm watching it tomorrow.
Oh, God. I really want them to put the 1978 Star Wars Holiday Special on Disney Plus. Can you please, 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 please? That would be amazing.
Did that air on ABC?
I'm fairly certain it probably... No, 20th Century TV.
Well, it's Fox, so...
So they own it because it's Fox. Oh, my God. I want it so bad. That would be fantastic. The Epcot Center opening celebration. They, of course, own that. That's not on there.
Let's touch on that for a minute. One thing that I think is sorely missing on Disney Plus is to be... None of us can speak this evening. The ability to watch the Disney Parks celebration.
All
content.
The opening day stuff or like anniversary
opening day
stuff
or yeah. Even just like sit down and catch catch a parade. I don't mean like live. Like I don't expect it to show up at 3:00 Eastern. It'd be cool if it did.
Yeah.
But you know, just I all the stuff hosted by LeVar.
Oh, or, he was great.
You know, all those Disney Parks live streams should be able to be, I think, pulled up.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, let's catch the Festival of Fantasy, or I've never seen what Paint the Night is. So instead of sending someone to YouTube,
right,
where, you know, touring plan videos gets their ad revenue.
Right.
Let's just be able to watch it where I'm already spending money.
That would be great.
And then also give me just one channel that's just music.
That would be kind of nice. Like, do you want like park music? You want like ambiance music? Or you want like Disney songs?
Don't care.
Okay.
I just give me three stations. I don't care. Or different blocks during the day. I don't need a DJ. Just don't make me try to pull it up on D Park Radio or Hulu or anything
Pandora
like that.
Or, you know, whatever.
Is that even still a thing? I haven't opened
Pandora
up in a
we listen
decade.
To it all the time. That's where we listen to the Disney songs in the car.
Oh,
that's okay. What we do.
I think those are, and that's just that's cheap. I mean, that is like, you don't have to film any content.
No, you already have it.
You just have to throw up some photographs.
Yeah.
Well, for music, you just put up some backgrounds that move and change and whatever. No one's watching it because they're just listening to it. It's in the background.
Right.
You know? And the same thing with, you know, with the parades and stuff like that or the events. I mean, I understand, I guess, part of the maybe, well, we don't want to show it to you. We want you to pay to come see it.
Okay, but like the stuff
that's
that we
like a
can't
commercial.
The stuff that we can't see anymore, they have to have professional filmings of those parades. They have
and
to
give me some of your vintage Disney produced vacation planning videos.
Oh my God, what's her name?
Stacy. Okay.
Give us some Stacy content.
Or her mom.
Or her mom. She's got it going on.
I've waited for so long.
Stacy, can't you see?
We just want more Disney.
All right, well, that's my list. That's it.
All right, bring back Firefly. Moving on. Maria, there's plenty of content out there. There's always going to be more content coming because that's the nature of streaming. But I think we've got great ideas. Yours probably better than mine.
No, I think yours were pretty damn good. This time.
Let's make it happen. I'm gonna write my congressman.
All right. I will too.
He's people that knows people. Speaking about knowing people, you got any new people you've let in lately?
No.
To the grout?
No. The summer is typically a little slower just because people are out doing stuff and not really on Facebook. So no, I think there's like one or two people in the queue. Four. Oh, and they've all answered the... Okay, so I'll have to let people in here pretty soon. There's a couple. We got a few. I let some people in last week, which by the time this comes out was a couple weeks ago. We've got some stuff going on. And we've got events. I'm not going to go through them because I don't know them all. But our main sheet up is Holiday Hijinks. We're going to be down December 1st and 2nd of this coming December. Epcot will be December 1st during the day, and December 2nd will be in Springs in the evening. As we get closer to those dates, we will put up more information on the group. So go there. We also have an event page, I believe. So if you want to go to Holiday Hijinks and you're not part of the event page, you can message one of us hosts or one of the admins, and we'll make sure that you're added to that list in case you would like to join us. So just this week, we had one or two people more say that they were coming, who the one was a solo traveler, and he was kind of hesitant. Because he's like, I don't know, I'm kind of a lurker in the group, and I don't really participate much, but like I kind of want to come. And immediately everybody was like, no, you have to come. Like, we will take care of you. You won't be alone. You'll be with us.
That's how we got our turkey.
That's right. And we love turkey. And it was really funny because Aaron Marie was relaying to him the story of how when we had our first, like, I guess official meetup years ago, before I, like, it was the first time I had met you guys, too.
I still haven't met you.
Yes, you have! Oh, my God. We were at Jacques Lindsay's, and she passed by Jacques Lindsay's, like, three or four times before she... And I could see her out there, because I was like, that girl just walked by. And then she walked by again.
Oh, she's lost.
And I was like, what is this girl doing? And finally she came in and she's like, hi, I'm Aaron Marie. And I was like, hi, I'm Maria. It was really cute. And then she was telling the guy how, like, Josh Wozni was like, Aaron, you got to come try this. Like, not even like, hi, I'm Josh, or hi, you must be Aaron. It was like immediately, you got to come try this whiskey, or you got to try this bourbon, or whatever it was that he was drinking at the time. And I don't know, that's just kind of how we are. You don't have to go through the awkward introductions with us. You're family, whether you like it or not, when you're part of this group. So, yeah, come down, have fun, get to know us, hang out with us. And if you want your alone time, then after that, if you want to go do your solo stuff, that's fine too. Like,
But if we see you, we are going to yell your name to you.
Oh, 100%. We're those obnoxious people.
But like good obnoxious.
Yeah. We should have a flag, really. We should be like one of the tour groups.
No, I think I haven't seen a flag in the parks in a long time.
I saw some the last time I was down.
Did you?
Yeah.
Were they yellow?
I don't remember. I can't remember. Okay. But it was definitely like they all had the same shirt on. It was.
I mean, we've had the flag one time.
That's true.
It was weird.
It was pretty fun.
Didn't help anybody get where they were going.
No, it sure didn't. Not at all.
Follow the flag. Well, that guy's lost already.
So. Yeah, so flag guy, come back.
All right. Well, there you have it. Join the group. She'll let you in. Ask the questions. Bob's your uncle.
Yep.
There are events, like she said, many events on the event page, cruises, races, the whole thing. Adam would say, we got things happening on our fitness group, 3 sheets to the finish line. People are running their own races. People are running marathons in London. There's a lot going on, and we're all supporting each other. So if you're interested in just maybe finding a nice, laid-back, supportive fitness group on Facebook that you can, let's be honest, most of the content of on that group is pictures of sweaty faces with a time and, yep, and a distance. That's the majority of it. And you know what? We're happy to see times, distances, and we want to see your sweaty face. So join us over there at 3 Sheets to the Finish Line. Just search that up on Facebook, and that'll get you in there. In the meantime, we're going to get out of here because I've got storms rolling in. Maria has to... I don't know what Maria does. I fucking have no idea what Maria does. We're going to go back to... Hey, well, thanks for listening tonight while we try to fix Disney's streaming woes and help push them into the black for the fourth quarter with some new accounts. We got your back here on 3 Sheets, Disney. You know that. Please sponsor us. I'd like to see Lighthouse Point. As always, we're going to get out here. So this isn't... Goodbye. See you real soon. So good night.
Good night.
You're welcome. And thank you.
When your room looks kind of weird and you wish that you weren't there, just close your eyes and make believe and you can be anywhere. There we go.